There are a number of different factors that must be considered in doing a thorough nutrition assessment. First, of course, you have to assess an individual's diet history. You have to figure out what they have been eating. You also need to consider a patient's health history, not just their own health, but also their family health history. Then you need to actually look at a patient. You need to do a physical exam. And lastly, it may be necessary to do lab tests to look at a patient's blood or sometimes urine in order to figure out what's going on with them nutritionally. Each of these components to a nutritional assessment has an important role to play in figuring out what's happening in a patient's body. When we're talking about diet history, we're talking about a patient's intake over several days. It includes portion sizes, it often includes computer analysis to figure out the exact nutrient intake. It may include having a patient write down what they ate yesterday or over the past week as exactly as they can. Taking a diet history is actually rather difficult. People tend to forget what they eat, or they may say they ate healthier than they actually did. People are also notoriously bad at judging and recalling portion sizes. There's a strong tendency to report smaller portions than a patient actually ate. A diet history is absolutely critical, though. Remember our discussion of primary versus secondary deficiency in the malnutrition video? Remember, primary deficiency is a deficiency caused by not taking in enough of a nutrient, and a secondary deficiency occurs when you're taking in plenty, but your body can't use it. The only way to really discriminate between these two is to do a good diet history and figure out how much of a nutrient a patient actually took in. Now, the health history includes a patient's personal health status, so if they have any disorders that affect their ability to eat or affect their body's ability to use the food that they eat. It may also include a patient's socioeconomic status, because income can affect food choices and overall health. It includes family health history. The family health history helps identify a patient's risk of nutrition-related diseases, like cardiovascular disease or type 2 diabetes, and it may help identify a possible genetic problem with nutrient digestion or absorption, some susceptibility to secondary deficiency. Health history may also include drug use, both prescription and otherwise. There are a number of interactions between drugs and the diet. This is a particular concern in elderly patients because elderly patients tend to be taking more prescription drugs. Drugs may affect a patient's nutrition by affecting their food intake. A drug may change a patient's appetite, may change the smell of food, may make a patient nauseous or dry-mouthed, limiting their desire to eat. Drugs may also affect how nutrients are absorbed or how nutrients are excreted. If a drug causes diarrhea or vomiting, or if it alters kidney function, that's going to affect how long a nutrient spends in the body. Drugs may also change how food is used. Some drugs interfere with the transport of nutrients in the blood or the use of nutrients within cells. Now, it's important to note that this goes the other way, too. Nutrition affects how medications act. Certain foods may change drug absorption, but they may change drug excretion. Some foods may make some drugs more toxic. Grapefruit is notorious for this. There are a variety of medications that are incompatible with grapefruit or grapefruit juice. These include psychological medications, these include immunosuppressants, these include statins, drugs to treat high blood pressure. Something in grapefruit and grapefruit juice increases the absorption of these medications. So a typical prescribed dose may now actually cause damage. Apart from diet history and a thorough health history, you also have laboratory tests, which may play an important role in detecting nutritional difficulties. Laboratory tests can detect subclinical nutritional deficiencies, so you may see a change in the blood before you actually see changes that would be detectable with a physical examination. a physical examination really only detects malnutrition when it has been going on long enough and has been severe enough that a patient is showing overt, clear signs and symptoms of dysfunction. One key component of a physical examination in nutrition assessment is taking anthropometric measurements. The prefix anthropo simply means pertaining to humans, and metric means measurement. So it's the human measuring measurements. There are several different anthropometric measurements that are standard in assessing nutrition status. First off, we have height and weight measurements. These can be key indicators of both overnutrition and undernutrition. And in children, both height and weight can be tracked over time to monitor growth. Waist circumference is another anthropometric measurement. This helps determine the distribution of fat, and specifically the amount of abdominal fat on the body. Skin fold measurements determine the thickness of subcutaneous fat. And lastly, head circumference is used in children. It's tracked over time in order to monitor brain development. As children grow, their head size should grow as the brain grows inside the skull. The most common anthropometric measurement is one that I'm sure you've heard of, the body mass index. The body mass index basically takes your weight in kilograms divided by the square of your height in meters. So it's simply a ratio of weight to height. You can calculate your body mass index pretty much anywhere on the web. If you just do a Google search for BMI calculators, you'll find a million of them. This is just showing you an example of a BMI calculator that you can find on the CDC's webpage. The body mass index is a slightly more accurate estimator of obesity than just taking weight alone, because the body mass index acknowledges that people that are taller tend to weigh more, even if they don't have more fat on their body. The BMI is divided into different categories. If you have a BMI below 18.5, you're considered to be underweight. 18.5 to 24.9 is normal. Above 25 is overweight. And above 30 is the obese category. And I have on this slide just an example of what this corresponds to in terms of actual weight for someone who is 5'9". If you are taller, you can weigh more before you get into the overweight or obese category. And if you're shorter, you'd be considered overweight or obese at a lower weight. Now, the reason why the BMI is found everywhere and why doctors and public health researchers love the BMI is because there are specific problems associated with being overweight or obese. People who are overweight or obese in these categories, particularly in the obese category, are at a higher risk of developing joint problems, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular problems. There are also a few health problems associated with being in the underweight category as well. You're more prone to osteoporosis, more prone to experience infertility. So the BMI is used as a rough estimate of how likely a person is to develop these conditions. But the BMI is problematic. It is a rough estimate, but it does not hold true in every case. Let me give you an example. Consider Mr. Wheeler. I don't mean to pick on Mr. Wheeler. I just picked his image and his statistics from a bodybuilding website. Now, think about this for a moment. Is this guy obese? It's ridiculous, right? He doesn't have a spare ounce of body fat on him. Clearly, he's not obese. Now, I took Mr. Wheeler's competition statistics and plugged it into the CDC's BMI calculator, and lo and behold, he falls into that obese category. By the BMI, this guy's obese. Now, do you think he's at an elevated risk for type 2 diabetes? Or for heart disease? Would it make sense for this guy's doctor to sit down with him and discuss good nutrition and the importance of exercise? I'm trying to make a point here, and the point is that the BMI has its limitations. And one of the major limitations of the BMI is that it does not take into account body composition. The BMI does not take into account muscle mass, and muscle is actually more dense than fat. Muscle weighs more than fat, if you took the same volume. So the BMI really should not be used to estimate the health risks of someone who is extremely muscular, like a bodybuilder or an elite athlete. A more direct way to measure the amount of fat on a person's body is to literally measure the amount of fat on a person's body. One way to do this is to take skin fold measurements. Skin fold measurements, you take a pair of calipers and literally pinch the skin on various places on the body. They're often taken at the back of the arm, on the back, or on the abdomen. This measures what is referred to as subcutaneous fat. Subcutaneous just means under the skin, so this is measuring the fat layer that lies underneath the skin, between the muscles and the skin. Skinfold measurements can be used to assess change over time. Like if you were in a fitness program, they might take skinfold measurements every time you weigh in to measure body fat percentage, as well as just weight changes. So these measurements can be used to estimate body density and body fat percentage, making them a better indicator of obesity than BMI. Another way to look at obesity is to measure the waist circumference, or the waist-to-hip ratio, waist circumference divided by hip circumference. They're really pretty comparable. Doing the waist-to-hip ratio does not give you much more information than just doing the waist circumference alone. In order to measure the waist circumference, you use a flexible measuring tape and wrap it around your waist at the smallest part of the natural waist, so usually about an inch above the navel or belly button. This gives you a direct measurement of abdominal obesity, sometimes called central obesity. Obesity in this region is most closely related to cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, and high blood pressure, all of the metabolic diseases that we associate with being obese. Research shows that it actually seems to matter more where we carry our extra weight. If you tend to carry extra weight in your hips and thighs, you're at less of a risk of developing cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes than someone who carries all of their excess weight in the abdomen. So measuring abdominal obesity is really looking directly at the fat that's most significantly associated with negative health outcomes. When you're tracking anthropometric measurements in children, you need to track them over time because children are growing rapidly and so their height and weight are constantly changing. These two charts are from the Centers for Disease Control, the CDC, and they show the percentiles for weight in girls between birth and 3 years of age, and length between birth and 3 years of age. Length is basically height before you start walking. The lines on these charts show you the different percentiles for weight and for length. If a child is on this 50th percentile line, that means that they are heavier or taller than 50% of children at the same age. If a child is above the 95th percentile, there's a concern of overnutrition. And if a child is below the 5th percentile, there's a concern of undernutrition. Now, since this is change over time, it's also important to watch for sudden changes. If a child is growing along in the 50th percentile, but then suddenly or over time kind of flattens out, that could indicate that the child has some sort of disease status going on or some sort of malnutrition situation and has stopped growing. This is an example weight chart for a severely undernourished child. Note that in these initial stages, the child is at a normal weight for their age, but then they develop a gastrointestinal infection and develop measles, and they drop down below the, well below the third percentile. Now, the doctor catches this, they realize that something's going on, they start rehabilitation, cure the gastroenteritis, treat the measles, and the child recovers and starts coming back up into the normal range for their age group. Head circumference is also tracked over time in children. It's used as an indicator of brain growth up until approximately 3 years of age. Decreased growth in head circumference may indicate undernutrition, but it may also indicate some sort of developmental disorder that is preventing growth of the brain. Physical examination is the act of looking at and listening to the body. So you can look at the state of the hair. Is it brittle or falling out? Look at the eyes. Are your eyes bright? Do they adjust easily to light? Can you see fine at night? You can look at the mouth, the teeth, gums, and tongue. Are your teeth healthy? Are your gums bleeding? Is your tongue red and bumpy like it should be? Is your skin smooth? Are your nails firm? Are you standing up straight? Are your legs straight? Do your muscles look wasted? All of these are part of a thorough physical examination. It also involves listening to the heart. Is the heart rate normal? Is blood pressure normal? It may involve testing a patient's reflexes or balance. Abnormal reflexes, poor balance, or even tingling sensations can indicate that something is wrong with the nervous system, which may be due to malnutrition. It's also important to ask about fatigue, confusion, mood. All of these can be indicators of malnutrition. One thing I do want to point out is that the physical examination is really just a starting point. You can't diagnose malnutrition on the basis of, say, an abnormal heart rate, or say that someone's fatigued, so therefore they're probably malnourished. The physical examination is just an indicator that something is wrong. And if something's wrong, it makes sense to consider nutrition status as one possible cause. The last part of assessing nutrition status is considering biochemical tests or lab tests. Remember that these tests may detect subclinical deficiencies that are already affecting your body's health, but are not yet so severe that you're showing clear physical signs. These tests are primarily done on blood, but they may be done on urine as well. Some can even be tested in hair. Chronic zinc deficiency comes out in your hair. Some of these lab tests may directly look for levels of specific nutrients, like testing for serum folate levels or serum B12 levels. Some tests look for metabolites of specific nutrients. A metabolite is something that a nutrient is converted into in the body. This is how you test for niacin in the blood. You look for niacin metabolites. A blood test may also look for molecules that use specific nutrients, like a hemoglobin test. Hemoglobin needs iron, so if you are low on hemoglobin, you may be iron deficient, or you could be folate deficient or vitamin B12 deficient. Together with diet history, health history, anthropometric measurements, and other physical examination, biochemical tests can provide important clues about the state of a patient's nutrition. Here are the questions you should be able to answer after studying this video. Explain how personal and family history may be used in a nutrition assessment. Explain what physical changes may indicate malnutrition. Explain how the nutritional status of a growing child may be assessed. Explain different methods of detecting overnutrition, such as the BMI, skin fold measurements, and waist circumference. And lastly, discuss the limitations of the body mass index.